the music. Start me up Monday morning. How's everybody doing? Yeah.
Yeah. Good.
It's fine. Everybody have a good weekend?
Yeah.
God, you guys look so serious this morning. Nobody's smiling. Except my, and we have my youngest new mentee, my first Moldavian. Everybody say hello to Sergio.
Hey, Sergio.
Hey, Sergio. Guys.
I always remember your first Moldavian.
Here I am.
15 years old.
This young man read my book last night and set up an appointment with me this morning. And everything. How cool is that? Give him a round of applause.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Millionaire, future millionaire by 21.
Tell us. Yeah, that's my goal.
Hey, you know, Alexander the Great ruled the world before he was 21. Don't limit yourself because of your age or self-imposed.
Using this as something very good. That I've just started so young.
Very good. Alan, you got a question. Oh, you thought.
Just putting a thumbs up.
Oh, it's a thumbs up. I'm sorry. Okay, everybody's coming.
We're all really jealous. We wish we were young again.
You know what?
Preach.
You're as old as you feel. Age is only a number. Okay, I've got underwear older than this kid.
Yeah.
Okay. You're not laughing. You guys have heard my jokes too often. Okay. The thing about it is, biologically, what do you do to take care of yourself so you can enjoy this little trip on the planet? Okay. Are you taking care of yourself? Are you eating right? It's this morning. I went with my daughter to the health club. I did 5 miles. I did a treadmill. I swam 10 laps. I did a sauna. Okay. And that's before 8:30 this morning. I'm going to have one meal today, only one meal. It's going to be very large, but it's going to be one meal. And you take care of yourself, enjoy life, and make enough money so you can enjoy it.
Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you for the amen.
Amen. Oh,
thank you to the Claude Diamond Church of Good Debt and Discount House, right? Hey, I've got a video to show you guys real fast here. And I'm going to play it from my iPad here. So I hope the sound is loud enough. It's very short and we'll discuss it.
Low man on the totem pole, that would be you.
Hey, Gerald.
Hi.
How you doing today?
All right, just came to have a second look.
See something, Gerald?
Yeah.
What's the problem? Exactly.
Sorry?
Why don't you let yourself have this car?
What do you mean?
What is it, really? Is it that you think if you buy this car, you're going to find another car you like better elsewhere immediately after buying it? Or is it that you just think you don't deserve the car?
You don't know me.
Gerald, please, I'm not insulting you, so please don't take it like that. Okay, I'm just trying to understand. Because all these salespeople around here, take a look at them. They sent me over here because they've given up on you. All right, they sent me, wheelchair guy, rookie, low man on the totem pole, to talk to you because none of them believe they pull the trigger on actually purchasing a vehicle. But let me tell you something. I know you love this car. You love this car so much you come in 2 days a week. 2 days a week to just look at it, and then you walk out. Gerald, life's too short. Life is too short. Okay? Things change in an instant. Take it from me. Okay, so be a man. Take control of your life. Be a man. Buy this car. Show all these people that they're wrong, that you can make a decision.
I'm gonna really think about it.
No more thinking, Gerald. No more thinking, no more dithering, no more wasting everybody's time, especially your own, because that's what you're doing. You're wasting your time every time you come in here. Buy this car because you love it and because you want this car and you want to drive off this lot in this car today. Buy it.
Okay.
Mr. Garrity.
Yes, sir.
All right, Gerald over here would like to go ahead and start paperwork on purchasing this hybrid here.
Yes, I would. Congratulations, Gerald.
Congratulations.
Well, thank you.
What happened in that? There's so much in that short video. It's from Friday Night Lights. I showed it.
He watched the Claude Diamond video on YouTube.
Yeah, same. Yeah.
I showed that video on Friday, Beer with Claude. What was in that video? There were so many takeaways in that video. First, what's some of the takeaways?
Social pressure.
He didn't let him think about it. He didn't.
One of the things I took away was the where he told him, you're making a mistake. You know, he made him told him, you want this, you need to do this. That's a mistake walking out of here.
Right. Did he talk about features and benefits? Did you hear a lot of that?
No. Motion.
Did you hear one feature and benefit? There was no feature and benefits. There was no formal presentation with slides, with brochures. There was no presentation at all. How did he close this guy?
Be a man.
You're not allowed to say no.
No, the part when he said, be a man and show these guys that you're a man and you can make a decision. He just pressured, pressure, some kind of.
Go ahead.
Yeah, that's some kind of social pressure or something like that, because be a man and make a decision and make them like show them that you can make a decision, you know, and that made him, yeah, I really can show them that I can do something. That's something triggered in your mind.
Exactly. He said, well, how dangerous was that move? Be a man. You've come in here, you looked at this car, none of the other salesmen want to talk to you anymore. You know you want this car. Be a man and make a decision. How dangerous is selling like that? How much assertiveness? If you had to give that an assertiveness score on 1 through 100, what would that assertiveness score be?
100.
200.
Yeah, I agree. How dangerous is it to sell that way?
Dangerous. It's dangerous.
Super. Yeah, he could have just turned around and say, who are you to say that to me?
I don't
depends if you're face to face or over Zoom.
Yeah. I don't think it was dangerous at all. This guy.
Not really.
I don't think it was dangerous at all. The only danger is maybe he'll react. He'll be mad at you. He'll reject you. But he wasn't going to buy anyway. What do you have to lose by going for it once in a while? By saying, you want this car. What's my new favorite thing? I have made a decision, Mr. Prospect. You're going to buy this car today. You're not allowed to think about it. We're done, sir. You want this car. You need this car. This is what you told me. These are your 3 to 6 needs and greeds. You're going to buy this car today or you're fired.
He cut right to the heart of it, Claude, and he gave the guy what he needed. He told the guy exactly what he needed to hear, right? That guy's been coming in there forever, wanting that car. He knows he wants it. He's not going to be coming. He's not walking on the lot unless he wants to buy, especially many, many times, right? He's become a meme. And he gave the guy what he needed to hear. Like, some people need that kick in the pants, that leadership, that kick in the pants, you know? They need that, you know, and then all the social pressure and everything on top of that. And the emotion, you know, feel better about yourself, be a man, you know? It was coming from a place of love. It wasn't trying to just, like, smash the guy, I think, you know?
He gave him permission to trust himself to buy it.
Is assertiveness, tough question here, is assertiveness a bad thing? If the prospect presumes, whoa, John, get a tissue. Is assertiveness a bad thing if the prospect believes it's in their best interest?
No.
No.
Why are we so scared to be assertive with prospects? Why are we doing all this ass-kissing stuff?
We don't want to hurt their feelings or we don't want them to reject us. Once we were too assertive, they tell us that they'll find somebody else to do business with.
Why don't we sell now?
Because traditional sales, we've always been told the customer is always right.
Well, you know, and that is the customer is not always right. Sometimes the customer, I think we sell emotionally. And I think when we sell in an assertive manner, sometimes, not every time, that's why I hate scripts, because I don't want to lock you into one type of selling. There are so many different psychological triggers. There are so many different emotions involved. There's different environments that you want to create with people sometimes. You cannot say one script, one method of selling fits all situations, right?
Yep.
I mean, if you were a carpenter, would you want just one tool on your belt, or would you want a lot of tools? You want the right tool at the right time. And that's why we practice. Now, we do want an outlining system, a macro system, which I'm going to talk about today. Absolutely. But selling assertively, we've all met. Am I the only one in the room who has met this person who calls you every 2-3 weeks? Hi, Claude. I just wanted to ask you one more question. I just wanted to ask you about the property. I was just thinking about something I never asked. Has everybody met this guy, this girl or guy?
Yeah.
And why do they behave like that? Why do they keep coming back to the well, keep coming back to us, asking questions? We give them the presentation again. We answer their questions, and then they'll say, I'll think about it. You're great. They give us a stroke, and then they dismiss us. Why do we sell this way?
This happens maybe because when he goes to you and he has a motivation, and then he goes there, and then in the process, when you're just talking about the product, he loses that motivation. Yeah. Is it
our fear of losing the prospect?
I agree, Kiss. I think it's a fear of losing the prospect because we don't. Hey, maybe we're a little. I think we're all insecure to some degree. I think we don't have enough warm prospects. Guess what happens when you have enough customers and you're making enough money? Do you think you would act differently if you were just having this thriving, wonderful business? Do you think you would speak differently and feel differently about yourself?
Yes.
Amen.
100%.
Yeah.
This guy also, he's the low man on the totem pole, the guy in the wheelchair. And everybody's already talked to this guy. Nobody thinks he's going to sell. He had nothing to lose.
And he gained everything by speaking. He made a commission.
His manager was shocked.
Yeah. He made a commission. He sold an expensive car. If you can do it with a car, can you do it with real estate?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Can you do it with an apartment building?
Mm-hmm.
You can do whatever you want.
Yeah. Sergio, my 23rd country today, my 15-year-old Moldavian here. Why you quit your job? Would you mind sharing your story why you quit your job the other day?
Okay. So, guys, I was working, selling online products on Instagram, joined a business, and, I was getting commission about $7 per one lead, and the lead needs to be like a $2,000 lead, $2,000. So the lead should be able to pay $2,000. In case if he can just $1,000, I don't get anything. So I was working. This is actually a bit hard to find good prospects on Instagram. It's not hard, but it takes time. So I was spending about 10 hours a day, even more in my first day, to get at least 2 leads, because if you don't get 2 leads, you're just getting fired because you don't get enough results, he said.
But you made $7. Why did you quit?
Imagine my brain was, man, I am spending 10 hours a day working for 2 leads to get $7, and he gets $4,000 for them. That's not what I wanted to do, with my life.
Why do I love this kid's thinking? Why do I love the way he's thinking right now? Did he have a revelation and epiphany here? Why do I love the conclusion he came to? Someone help me.
Thinking out of the box.
Anybody?
If you're making somebody else money, why not make money for yourself?
Oh, say it again. Who said that?
Christian. If you're making somebody else money, why not just do it for yourself?
Yeah. Yeah. So you can go through life being a spectator or a participant. Do you want to watch somebody else throw the ball around, or do you want to be on the field throwing the ball? Do you want to make the big money, or do you want to make somebody else money? There's nothing wrong with working for somebody else. Okay. But do we want...
But yeah.
Go ahead.
We all want the best for us. You know, life is short and we all want to enjoy it. So I see no reason to stay and to make someone rich and you just get your freaking $7 for all the work.
Yeah. It's an epiphany. It's a revelation. And once you see... that you can make the $2,000 instead of the $7, but it takes a lot of guts sometimes to say, oh, I'm not going to get that regular paycheck. I'm not going to get those little, I'm not going to be able to participate in cupcake or a cupcake Wednesday or Taco Tuesday with my employees anymore, right?
Yeah. Casual Fridays.
He just said something that most people don't say until they're 30 or 40. Life is too short, and he's still a teenager, and he sees that his life is too short.
Life is too short.
Amazing.
Is it all about the money? I mean, why are we in business to make money today? Is it just the money though? Money, we all want money. I'm very straightforward about that. But what else do you get when you have the superpower to get on the phone to talk to people? To generate income, what else do you get out of that besides
freedom,
confidence?
It's not the money, Claude. It's what the money can do for us and our families, the opportunities and options it can provide. You come from a whole different place when you're good on that.
Yeah.
And then the confidence, everything else says wealth is great. You're in the right place, dude. Whoever the new guy is, forgot your name.
Welcome. Yeah.
You always say it's the freedom.
What does freedom mean? What does freedom mean to you?
Better coffee and cleaner toilets.
Yes.
We're stealing all your shit.
It's okay. You're not stealing it. I'm giving it to you because it took me so long to get to that happy place. Okay. What's that one movie? Oh, God, with the guy from Saturday Night Live, The Happy Place.
Happy Gilmore.
Happy Gilmore, thank you. Yes, that my happy place, all unicorns and rainbows and everything. What's your happy place? My happy place was freedom of worry about money, about taking care of my family, about paying my obligations, removing all debt, never having to owe another person that money I borrowed or loans or mortgages and credit cards and things, to be totally free from that kind of pressure in life. I mean, that was my freedom, the freedom to go to bed. And here it is, the freedom to go to bed and not think about money. Has anyone else had that pressure on them? I hate that. I hated that. Once I got that out of my life, to be able to just say, I can sleep, I can have nice dreams, I can get up in the morning and look forward to work, look forward to what I'm selling. It's got to be more than the money, right? It's what the money will give you. Okay, let's go to a few basics here. We're in a boardroom. You've been invited to speak to a company and they're interested in your widget. And you come in front of the boardroom and there's 25 people around the table. I did this last week. I'm going to see if it took. Okay. What are you going to say to those people, Bailey? You just walked in the room and ladies and gentlemen, Bailey's here. He's going to tell us about his brand new widget.
Hey, does anybody know why I'm here? Do you know?
I don't know. We're looking, we're kind of interested in your widget there, Bailey.
Oh, Claude, I remember the line you told us, man. And I thought it did it right. It could have been better.
Who else wants
to? Awesome. Yeah.
Why am I here? What else would you say? What else would you say to that room full of, you got 50 eyeballs on you. You got all these people staring at you and they've done several interviews with your competition. What did your competition do? The boring amateur competition. What did the other five salesmen do before you? What do you think?
Presentation.
Yeah,
presentation. PowerPoint.
Features and benefits.
Slides.
Yeah.
Bad
PowerPoint.
Yeah. Yeah. What does the GUT salesperson do? Right in the beginning, right up front, New York City style, no time wasting, no bullshit. What does the GUT salesperson do right in the beginning?
Hey guys, pattern thanks interrupt. For inviting me, but why am I here? What do I do here?
I love this kid.
what else could you say? Give me another opener. Ask the question to the boss. The CEO is sitting right next to you. He's sitting down. You're standing up with all these people looking at you. What do you say to the CEO next?
Well, everybody, what is it you need from me?
Well, we want to find out about your widget. We're investigating right now six-inch widgets. And we heard, and you know, we're just looking for the company that can help us provide the right widget.
So you guys have a problem.
Say again, Bill.
You guys have a problem.
Well, yeah, it's something. We already have we're working with a company, but they haven't, we think we can do better. You know, that's why we invited you here.
May I ask who provides you right now with your widgets?
We get our widgets from Golden Widget Company. Golden Widget Company.
Oh, but seems like a good company. What's the problem with them?
See, what did he just off? That was brilliant. What did this kid just do?
Trying to I remember the negative. Scale. I remember the scale, and we need to go up. We need to go up. Now it's a one from. It's not that much of a need for you right now, so we need to scale it up.
You got
to get to the heart of the matter.
Yes, we got to get to the heart. All right, and that's even a little redirection. You were ready. Oh, you have a company already. How long you been with Golden Widget? Oh. I'll answer that question to Sergio. Sergio, they've been providing widgets for us for 15 years.
That seems like a lot. And what's the problem in continuing doing business with them? That if you did for so many years, what's the problem to continue?
That's not bad. That's not bad. I want to see a better redirection, though. Mm-hmm. What do you want to change? You've been with them for 15.
Oh, yeah.
No, go ahead.
Yeah, you've been with them for 15 years. Why do you want to make a change?
Well, give them a stroke now. They're a good company. Do a positive redirection now, too. Mm-hmm.
So you've been with them for 15 years, and I know from them that they're a very good company. What makes you to want to make a change?
You know, they're not that good. They've been dropping the ball. Deliveries have been really late lately. The quality is okay, but it's not great. The deliveries are our biggest problem. We're very busy right now. And 2 weeks ago, they totally missed the delivery. We had to call up all our customers and tell them why we couldn't deliver. It was embarrassing. We lost a lot of money. That's why you're here.
So I see that there's a struggle for you. And
give me a cookie. Say thank you for that information first.
Yeah, thank you for that information. Is that problem with a delivery something that bothers you right now?
Yeah, that's what I just said. Alex Wosick, step in now.
Yeah.
So, I mean, why is this important to you guys?
Well, I just told you. I mean, we're losing money. It's embarrassing to our customers. I've always prided myself on good deliveries, and this company is having a problem with their union, with their trucks. They're not repairing them. They're having a lot of breakdowns. This is our biggest truck problem. How's your delivery system with how's your delivery with your company?
I mean, that's a great question. I mean, there's a reason why you asked that. I'm sure that they could figure that out. I mean, haven't you taken this up with them that they could figure it out for you?
Okay, you're losing me. You're losing me.
Too much.
Really?
You're losing me. Somebody take over. Go ahead, Dave.
Wow. It sounds like you guys have a serious problem. What would you like to see from me today?
Nope, too early. You're trying to kiss me and you haven't bought me a drink yet.
Oh, okay.
So imagine for a moment.
Yeah.
So imagine for a moment if we fix, if we, you get to a company that can deliver you the widgets on time, would it be a solution for?
That's what we're, that's what I'm looking for. But I understand your company is 20% more expensive. I'm throwing you out a stall and objection, and I'm going to give you a rule. Okay. I'm going to keep this real. This is a good role play. Okay. Money is never an objection to doing business if the need is great enough. On a 1 through 10, what's my need right now?
8 to 9.
How many needs and greeds did I give you about how pissed off I am about deliveries, losing money? How many, Alan, Brian?
I counted 4.
At least 4. Now you summarize. This is commitment to close, and you charge 20% more. Close me, Alan. Close me right now.
I understand. It's been embarrassing for you and your customers, delayed deliveries, and you couldn't get the product out. Imagine for a moment we could resolve all of that today. What would you like to do next, Claude?
That's what I'm looking for. But you guys charge more, don't you?
Great point. You know what? I appreciate you bringing that up. Do you know why we have to charge that much?
I'm not sure.
You want me to tell you the truth or make you feel good?
Truth, man.
That's because we're able to deliver on our promises.
That's it.
Yeah.
That's it. Now, close me. One sentence. Close
Claude, me. How would you like to proceed?
Okay, summarize and close me. Somebody else. Ben Jasso, step into his shoes. Close me.
Claude, I've been there. I know it's like to have to make the call to your clients. I hate it. We don't tolerate it around here. We have a delivery rate. I can send you the references. We're 99.5% on time all the time, 24/7, 365. You're not going to have to make those calls anymore. That's not going to happen to your company. We do charge a little more because we have that kind of that service. We guarantee it. What would you like to do next, Claude?
Ask it stronger. Claude, I've made a decision. We're going to fix this problem. Can you say yes? Can you say yes now? And imagine end of this week, deliveries are back on time. You're making money. Your customers are happy. Make it strong. Make it powerful. Make it emotional. Close me.
You've got a problem there for sure. We are the company. We have a 98.5% accuracy rate. That's why we charge a little more. We can get out of this mess together right now. Right now. Imagine. You don't have to worry about it anymore. Your customer is secure. What do you want to do, Claude? How do we proceed next?
You missed my you missed my most important closing. Suzette, want to step in? Let's let the ladies have a shot here. Tell me you have made a decision.
Claude, I've made a decision. We're going to be able to help you with taking care of all those problems that you saw before. We're going to help. We're going to take care of the delivery, and we're going to take care of all those things. What would you like to do next?
A little stronger. I want it even more. Claude, hey, Mr. CEO, I've made a decision. You got a problem. You're losing money. You're getting pissed off. It's not your fault. Okay. We charge more because we keep better trucks, newer trucks, and we take care of our maintenance so that you don't have the problems you're talking about. So your deliveries are on time, you make more money, and you're not embarrassing. I can't even imagine what that's like for you to call up your customers and tell them you can't make deliveries because of this other company. I can't even imagine how you feel. It's embarrassing, isn't it? I've made a decision. We're going to do this today. We're going to do this right now. And your problems are over. Are we on the same page?
Yeah, sounds like it. Yes.
Which means?
Tell me what we do next. Boom. We sign a paper, sign a contract.
Right now, and we'll get to work on it. Thank you for your trust in your business, Suzette. Boom.
My pleasure.
That's gut selling. Do you hear all the different moves, the passion, the things about it? Did I tell them all about how our widget is made?
Nothing.
You know, all the different sizes of our wood. Did I get into all the features and benefits?
No.
See, in GUT.S, we close first with emotion. We get the prospect involved. We learn. Remember the last couple of weeks we talked about Socratic questions and selling?
Mm-hmm.
How to ask those questions. It's not about the features and benefits. It's about the emotion in the very beginning. Most people sell with premature presentations and scripts. GUT.S is about going right to the heart of the matter. What's the worst they could say? They say it anyway, even with scripts and all the other little tricks and gimmicks and everything. They say no, or I'll think about it. What if you have to lose by being direct, being assertive, and being passionate? What do you have to lose?
Nothing. You're just gaining experience.
Yeah. This is the way to sell, ladies. This is the way you go to the bank with people. Because otherwise, they're just going to treat you like everyone else. Like there's no, there's no immediacy. There's no urgency. Is it our responsibility to make it painful in the prospect?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, we got
no pain, no gain.
Yeah, no pain, no gain. Welcome, Dr. Vibe.
How you doing, Claude? How are things?
Hey, great, man. Good to see you on board here.
Yes, I'm listening and learning. This has helped me in my business ventures, even though I'm not in real estate. So this works with anything, folks, anything.
Do you think, I'm not going to get political, Dr. Vibe, but do you think in a woke society where we don't want to offend anybody or ruffle any feathers, do you think we're losing out by not being assertive if it's in the best interest of the party we're trying to communicate with?
Not at all. It's all in tone and voice. You can be, if you know how to control your tone and voice and you know your client or clients, it's not, be on the offensive, not on the defensive.
How, even in a cold call or an initial meeting, do you think you can do it in such a way, delicate, you're a surgeon with a scalpel, but instead of a scalpel, you're using your words in such a way that you can intrigue other people or make them feel you care and trust them, you care about them, and you're trying to create that trust. Can we go to somebody in an initial meeting or in social or business and say, you know what, I've made a decision. I have an idea. I have a solution for you. Can I tell you about it? This is the solid. This is what will work. This is what you need. This is what worked for me. Let me tell you about a story that worked for other people. Is it okay to say this, or should I just leave you alone?
Sure, sure. Go ahead.
Have we forgot how to communicate to sell this way to people because we're so scared of rejection or that maybe somebody else will not like us?
Yeah. Yes. Yes.
I love people. I love direct, outspoken people. Does everybody here have a grandma who says things at the Thanksgiving Day table that maybe nobody else would say, and everybody loves her because she said it, and they laugh and everything, and say, "Boy, I'm glad I didn't say that."
Okay, yeah, but that's fine, Robert.
I'm Italian.
It's amazing. It's amazing. Let's any questions? Quick open forum here, and then I have some slides and things like that. But it won't be a intellectual presentation. I wanted to go over the basics of the GUT.S sales method with you guys. And look, lovely Marnie is here.
Hey. So I completely rewrote that whole entire thing that I posted in the Skype room yesterday because it was just too much for the first thing.
Too long.
So yeah. Way too long and getting into the backstory. And so I completely redid the whole thing, kind of went straight for the jugular, chunked it down quite a bit. And, you know, I saved the rest. If they're interested, now I can get into, you know, less, the other stuff.
Marnie is less more sometimes.
Yes, exactly.
What is the girl? I forget the actress's name, in Jerry Maguire. When Tom Cruise professes his love and she interrupts him and she says, "You had me at hello."
Renee Zellweger.
Thank you. You had me at hello. Don't you
kind of like what is the got milk, you know, or just do it. Yeah. So I cut it down by about half, you know.
What's your objective though?
my objective.
One sentence. Answer that in one sentence.
To get referral partners.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
How do you get a referral? Did someone wake up this morning and said, gee, I'm going to go on the internet and look and call up Marnie and find out if I can become a referral partner?
No.
What is the incentive that you have to create to make somebody want to do business with you, to call you, to go to your webpage? Did they just wake up and want a long letter with a lot of blue sky? How do you create an incentive?
Intrigue, intriguing enough that they feel compelled to, want to hear more.
Yeah.
And nice. I think I did that. I think I did that. But I'm open. If you guys, even if you hate it, I want to know.
Claude, I'll add on something here, developing a conversation and finding out what their pain points are.
Yes, very good. What are the pain points of the people you're trying to attract? What is the problem you're solving? What's the main issue for someone to take an action? You're trying to create a reaction. You want someone to contact you so you can do business with them so that they can make money and you can get more prospects. True or false?
True. So then I wonder if I put, because I chunked it down so much that I took out the part where I said, maybe you're looking for a career change or just need additional income. Maybe I need to put that back in because I did kind of go for it.
Can I just butt in? I don't know about career change, but to me, it's about easy money. Hey, I know somebody who needs a solar. Why not just give you the name and I get 50%? That's what I want.
Yeah. I like that. Interesting. Okay. So
how about one thing I noticed in your letter that was missing?
Yeah.
Phone number. Call me right now if you'd like an opportunity. I need a business partner today who wants to make money by working with me in an environmental industry, not only making money, but making the planet safer for everyone. I answer my own phone. Call me now.
Wow. Okay. Woo. That's super helpful.
What do I say at the end of every one of my videos on YouTube?
I have my own phone. I always have my phone with me. Call me.
I answer my own phone.
This
is why I love kitchen table businesses. Okay. I don't need 10 million people. I just need a few people every day. If a few people every day call me, set up appointments for my webpage calendar, a few people buy my products, a few people email me. What happens to my business if I have the sales skills and I attract a few quality customers or prospects every day?
Right.
We don't have to. We think we have to be Amazon and all this stuff. I love being a small business working out of my homes with no overhead and no employee issues. I love being small. Think big, but be small. Is there anything wrong with that?
No, I agree 150%, Claude. I tell people you don't need everybody. You need the right people.
Yeah.
The right people. Because if you find the right people, they're going to lead you to other right people. And they're going to become your brand ambassadors. So it reduces your workload. So you want those people that know, like, and trust you. And if you serve them good, it's like when you go see a movie. When you see a good movie, what do? You tell other people about it. When people get good service, they're going to tell other people about it. So those people become your brand ambassadors. That's what I term them. You want your brand ambassadors.
What is the secret to entrepreneurship, Dr. Vibe? I mean, what's the mistake that starting or budding entrepreneurs all do? They overspend in the beginning. They go into the red before they're ever in the black. They increase their overhead instead of thinking about running a lean, mean machine. Is there anything wrong with that?
Not at all, Claude. I remember one of the first things you told me that I still use today with people, as I say, give good phone. Claudia!
Hello, there she is. Hey, gorgeous.
Yeah.
We have a Canadian and a Moldavian.
Woo! Cool. Yes. And then a bunch of Americans too.
Yeah.
But Claude, I've never forgot about that. Give good phone, right? And and someone told me a long time ago, he said, Dr. Vibe, if it's facts, you can do
say that overall. Dr. So Vibe, we lost that last 20 seconds. Say that again, please.
No, I'll repeat again that I've learned that if you want to just communicate facts, a text is good. But if it involves anything emotional, you either want to do it face-to-face or over phone.
Can you sell $1 million house by texting? I'm sure there's somebody who has a story like that. But what's in your best interest in terms of sales, persuasion, influence, marketing?
Get on the phone.
Get on the phone.
By text. Yeah. But if it's emotions, you, Claude, can I add one other thing?
Absolutely.
Another key thing that a lot of people don't do, and if you do it, you'll stand out in a good way, follow up and follow through.
Follow up is important. Can we close everybody in the first phone call? Of course not.
No.
No, no. But we've established a foundation. How do you build a good house? You start with a sturdy foundation, and then you slowly, as it rises and builds, you know, that's how you do it. So sometimes you'll speak to somebody. It's not the right time. The money isn't there. They don't have the authority. It's not enough needs and greeds. There's not enough pain yet involved. But if you have a follow-up system, like Dr. Vibe just said, say you call them back in 2 weeks or in 2 months or at Christmas, do situations change? And do you have your follow-up information? Do you write down all the notes on this person? And you go, hey, Dr. Vibe, Claude Diamond, we spoke way back in August, and I wanted to see if that problem was resolved. And if not, maybe I have a few solutions for you. How are you, sir? Is the problem still there?
That's key. When I'm in situations like that, Claude, what I tell people is, do I have your permission, or is it okay to follow up with you in 2 weeks, 3 months, etc.? So when you're calling back, it's because they gave you permission to call back. It's not you're not intruding in their space. They gave you permission. So it sort of reduces that barrier. You're not making a cold call. You're making a call that they allowed you to make.
Call them back anyway, even if they don't give you permission. They won't remember you today. They won't remember you 2 hours later. Okay, you know, Dr. Vibe, you probably don't remember me. I spoke with you way back in August, and you had that problem with that. You were looking to buy a brand new Rolls Royce up there. Did you ever get that car, sir? I just had to follow up. I was curious. Can you help me?
Yeah, a lot of times that person will say, hey, thanks for asking. Bang.
What happens when you speak to somebody, you take good notes, you know their dog is Spot, you know their wife is Betty Lou, you know their favorite flavor ice cream is chocolate. When you call them back and you have this little bit of information, what's going on here in turn? What's the psychology, the environment of persuading that person when you have a little bit of information? Are you still a stranger?
No.
No,
not anymore.
Right. What's the 11th commandment? Who remembers it?
You can treat a salesperson like crap and still get into heaven.
So if we don't act like the quote unquote salesperson, like we're an old friend, a next door neighbor, a college buddy, or just a concerned person getting back to them, and we act the right way and we have a little bit of facts from a previous conversation, mathematically, do we have a better chance of engaging that person?
Absolutely, sure. Because they're seeing that you're paying attention to what they're saying and they feel valued.
Yes. Is that a stroke, by the way?
Mm-hmm.
Dr. Vibe, last time we spoke, I remember we talked all about why you're in your business. You need a new home because you entertain people. And I wrote a lot of notes on this. Did you ever solve that problem, sir? Boom. So you can use the information to engage you. See, and is a less chance of rejection. People are rejected. How fast in today's environment, we're inundated with phone calls and texting and robocalls and everything. How fast do prospects reject us when we're a stranger?
New York second.
Yeah.
New York second, a nanosecond, right? But would we speak that way to the nice old lady who lives next door to us? How about the guy? How about the mailman who delivers our mail?
Okay. Probably not, no.
Go ahead, Marnie.
So I don't know if this is in context with what we're discussing. And if not, we can always talk about it later. But because I mentioned to you in a separate Skype that I'm going to be having people reach out to businesses such as roofers and realtors and whatnot to see if they want to become referral partners. All I want to do is get them, get an appointment with me. So like a 20-second, 30-second thing for them to say. But these are not GUTS people. So they're not going to be like, hey, you know, they're not going to be brilliant like us. And so I'm just wondering, you know, but they want to know what to say. So I kind of have to give them at least a loose script. And I would say to them, hey, we don't really like scripts, so be creative. But this is kind of the gist of what you want to get across.
Sure. Give them an outline. Give them some openers. Hi, I'm sorry it took me so long to get back to you. I understand you're interested in solar panels. And in something like that. Act like always, we're playing roles. We're psychologists and we're thespians at the same time. If we have to play a role, and this is difficult. This is the $1 million skill, and it doesn't come easy.
Businesses though, so they're going to think they had the wrong number because these people probably haven't even thought about solar, right? So it's a little bit different. They're calling a company to say, hey, you know, we'd love to partner with you, kind of thing.
You think they get those phone calls all day long?
Yeah.
So this is the definition of insanity. We're doing the same thing over and over and we're expecting a different result. It's like buying a lottery ticket. This is the winner. But 20 million other people bought that same ticket. We've got to look at things and do things differently. If I call you up at the company, okay, you're the receptionist, and I need to speak to Miss Marchant, the CEO, and I call you up. Go ahead, answer the phone for the big company.
Hi, Roofing ABC, can I help you?
Yeah, hi, I wanted to see if Marnie's free for lunch. I can't remember the last time we got together. Put me through, please.
Okay, who am I speaking with?
This is Claude, and I wanted to see if Miss Marchant, Marnie, if she's free for lunch. I'm in town right now. I'd love to get together with her.
Now, Claude, these people are in different states.
I don't care where they are.
Oh.
I only have one objective. What is it?
Getting on the phone.
If I get her on the phone, listen, I can invite her for lunch. I can reschedule it another time. I can send her a candygram or a box of pears or something. I can fix that later. But if I don't speak to Miss Marchant, the CEO, am I going to make any money today?
Nope.
See, we do all the busy work. We do all the things that, oh, I'm so busy. I'm so tired. I made 80 phone calls today. But how many people did you really speak to where you have created the opportunity? Sale. What do I always say about sale? It's dangerous.
Now, you don't think they're going to, because when they realize, like, I'm in Washington and they're in Florida, that they're going to be like, okay, wait a minute, why did this person say they wanted to invite me?
How are they going to know? It's cell phone land today. Nobody knows where anybody is on a cell phone.
Because hopefully we're going to actually get on a call and talk to that person. And then won't they feel a little bit like, oh, that was a little sketch? You know what I mean?
The only thing I want to do is talk to 5 people a day. I don't care where, I don't care where they live. I don't care what they situate. Now, if your situation is an anomaly, is something where you have to be geographically near the person or something like that, you adjust, you modify, you be creative. Creativity is so important in sales, okay? But you first got to get their attention. If you're just leaving voicemails all day long or speaking to guardians at the gate who don't care who you are, and you're not speaking to decision makers about your great product or service or opportunities, what's the chance you're going to get that sale?
Right.
You got to get to the right people, the right time. You got to fight for it and you got to be creative. I want to talk a little bit. I want to go back to, it's a good point I hope we helped you a little. Rewrite that letter and post it again. It was very good. I would just tighten it up a little. Put your contact information in there.
Okay, I'm going to do that. I rewrote it, but I'm going to add what you guys said and I'll repost.
Let me share one thing. I just remembered something. You guys notice what I did is I love Zoom. I have Zoom. I'll tell you a little secret. I have Zoom on most of the day. Do you know people sporadically call me on Zoom because I created a GoDaddy address? So instead of that long Zoom thing with all the numbers and everything, I Zoom is now forwarded to zoomclaude.com. And every now and then during the day, somebody comes onto my pay, comes onto Zoom, they go into the waiting room and I turn it on and they look at me, oh my God, I got a real person. I've got people, I want to attract people and I want to make it as easy to contact me as possible. Use Zoom, give them zoommarnie.com. Set that up for $5 on GoDaddy or whatever they charge. Okay. Give your phone number or Google Voice number. Set up a web page with a calendar scheduling system so people can go in there and schedule time with you. Make it so you attract enough prospects every day and you're putting the math in your favor.
ZoomMarnie.com. And then you actually get like a landing page and put your.
No, you're just going to forward it to your actual Zoom page. You can set up one permanent Zoom link as your permanent link. And then you make something that's real easy to, remember. And then people can go, oh, let me see if she's really there. A lot of times people go, wow, you're really here. You did answer your phone. You are on Zoom. All I want to do is one thing really simple. I just want to get, I want to get to 5 reasonable quality prospects a day. That's all I need to make my business prosper.
Wow. And where do you put your calendar link with that whole thing?
My
you mentioned get a calendar link too.
I use Book Like a Boss, and inside of Book Like a Boss is embedded a calendar like Calendly and all the other scheduling systems. I want a web page with information and a calendar. We've talked about that in previous Mondays here. I want to make it so easy for people to call me, Zoom me, text me, or schedule with me. Why?
Because that's
more plans, more money.
Yeah. See, I look at things differently. I have an extra chromosome or something's wrong with me. I don't want to make hundreds or thousands of calls to people who don't want to hear from me. Is that crazy or what? What's wrong with me?
Totally.
I don't want to bother people who have no idea who I am, who don't want to hear from me, who want to reject me and hang up the phone on me all day long. I can't stay motivated and passionate that way. But if I speak to people who have an inkling of interest or curiosity, I can qualify them quickly and I have an opportunity at least.
So Claude, that Zoom Claude, if they go there and you're not there because you're doing something else or whatever, is that where you have your Book Like a Boss link and then they could go on there and schedule with you?
Yeah, they can either go to my Book Like a Boss, ClaudeDiamond.com and schedule with me. They can call me. I always leave, what do I leave at the end of every video that I do, all my marketing? I leave a phone number. Okay. Or I say, go to my webpage, ClaudeDiamond.com. Make it easy for people. Put out original, organic content or creative content and make it easy for people to contact you or be rewarded by you. Okay. I want to move to one. We only have a few minutes left and I want to go to the share screen here. Good. I could talk to you forever, Marnie. Thank you.
You too, Claude. Thank
you. Can you guys see my screen?
Yep.
Okay, this is the basics here. 3 steps. GUTS, never forget this. GUTS is a question-based system. We ask questions with stroking, nurturing, and empathy. We use a lot of redirection, like we did in the role play with Sergio before. Well, gee, you're working with that company for 15 years. Why do you don't really want to change, do you? They're a good company. No, they're not, because, and you force people to justify their decisions by using that redirection. You start, so we're a question-based system, 3 simple steps, agenda. At some point you wanna set, this is, listen, This is the way I can help you solve your problem. Okay, so can I just ask you 2-3 questions? I'm not going to give you a formal presentation. I just need a little bit more information. I'm going to make you an offer. I'm going to offer you some solutions on your problem, and maybe we can do business together. And if we can't, would you do me a favor and fire me? It's okay to say no to me. That's an agenda. That's the agenda step. Okay. Draw a roadmap for them. Ask questions with redirections. It's okay for both of us. Just say yes or no. Gain their trust. Please fire me. What we're trying to do is create an adult to adult conversation. You guys can still see my screen. Okay.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Yep.
Okay. Good. Good. Have you ever met a salesperson who told you to say no? Why is that such an important step up front? Why do we tell a prospect, fire me? Don't have to think about it. Just tell me to get lost. Why is that so important?
Don't waste any time.
You're not going to beat them to death.
What do you think's going on in their head when you tell them, look, I'm here for you. I want to help you. But if it's not right, it's not within your budget time frame, what your needs are, you don't like my haircut, we can say it's over. Why is that so different from everyone else? Why do we do that?
Respect people's time. Pattern interrupt.
Right. What else? Go deep, though.
Nobody else says it.
Yeah, but why? What's the why here? Go deep, guys.
You're getting them to lower their barriers by being able to fire you and just tell you no.
You think you're relaxing them. Oh, God, I don't have a high-pressure dudette here. I don't have a high-pressure person. This person sounds like they actually care or are interested, and they're not pressuring me. Does that relax the environment completely?
Yes.
Absolutely. Let's move on here. So that's your agenda step. Qualification. Screen okay?
Yes.
Okay. We need to find out. Most important one. I shouldn't have it down here. It should be up here front. What happens if they don't have the money, the credit, or the finances to buy your widget, your real estate, whatever? If they don't have it, is it over?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
So if you find out upfront that they don't have money, credit, financing, support, co-signer, whatever you're looking for, it's not in their budget. How much time should you spend with this person?
Under 3 minutes.
Are we allowed, this is going to be tough for you guys, are we allowed to fire the prospect if they do not meet with our needs?
Yes.
Yes.
Say it like you mean it, guys.
Yeah.
Yes.
The salesman has rights.
We have rights. Great. Thank you, David. We have rights in the sales process. We have to discover their needs, their greeds, their problems, their pains. We have to qualify what's their emotional EQ, their emotional quotient. What is their behavior? What is their passion? We do that by asking questions, maybe telling stories, by asking them redirection once again. Gee, I don't understand. Why do you want to sell a house? You've been in it 15 years, stay in it another 15. We got to give them a score or a rating, okay? If we can't get them over a 4 or 5 and we've spoken to them for 15, 20, 30 minutes or more, are we going to close that person?
No.
No, get off the phone with them. You're wasting your time.
Can you give an example of how you would just cut them off and end it?
Dave, if I understand you correctly, you really don't want to sell your home until maybe next year sometime. Right now, the kid's got to finish school, and you don't really want to move until next January, February. Maybe we should, why don't we schedule about 30, 40 days before that? I'll call you around Thanksgiving and we'll focus on that, because it doesn't sound like you're ready to make that decision right now. Is that a fair assessment, Dave?
Actually, yes.
Okay, this is what I am going to do. It's been really nice to speak with you, meet your family. I'm going to send you guys a little gift. I'm going to send a video summarizing what we can do and how we can solve your problem. And I'm going to set up an appointment for November 5th on Zoom. And we're going to talk some more at that time when you're closer to being ready. Is that fair?
Totally.
I love doing business with you, sir. Thank you.
Boom. Thank you.
Yeah. Character matters. And then we go to the close. We're almost out of time here. We've got to get commitment, micro commitments. We've talked about that a couple of weeks ago. We got to move up the, we commitment to close. We've got to qualify them. And then we got that commitment. Once we get that commitment, we can satisfy their needs and greeds. Finally, with the presentation, this is where we, after we get the commitment, we've qualified them for money, time, decision, everything else. This is when now we present the intellectual properties of our features or, and benefits. Okay, this is the problem you have, Mr. and Mrs. Prospect. This is how we can solve the problem. This is how we can work it in your budget. Now you tell them about the horsepower, the little intellectual gobbledygook. You review, once again, keep it emotional. You review their needs, their fears, their joys, multiple times, needs and greeds. And then you make them buy by asking the question, Dave, this is your problem. This is how we can solve it. You told me if you found a solution, I think we have. I have made a decision that we're going to do business today. How do you feel about that? What would you like to do next? Are you ready to be a man and make this decision in the best interest of your company today?
Yes.
That's the question that you ask. And then you do the don't love and leave. You've got to do the post-sell step. Very, very important to do a post-sell step. And everybody here, who knows what, who's going to take a, somebody explain what a post-sell step is.
That's the button up and where you basically solidify their commitment and give them ways to work through the buyer's remorse.
Bailey, I'm so happy we're doing business. I love your widget. You've really been patient with me and everything. I'm so glad we're doing business. Thank you. So send me all that information. And I can't wait to tell my wife about it. And everything is great. Thank you so much. Give me a poll.
Oh, that's all. Yeah, you know, Claude, that's great, man. I'm really looking forward to working with you as well. And I know this is going to do great things for you. We're going to be able to deliver those widgets on time. You're going to be able to sleep so much better at night, knowing that you're not going to have to go back and, you know, tell your customers that, we screwed up again or we're late again. You're going to sleep better. You're going to feel so much better being able to do that moving forward. Right, Claude?
Absolutely.
And I know, you know, your wife's going to be able to appreciate you more and because you're going to be in a better nature, not having to have all this monkey on your back. You know, she's going to love it as well. And, you know, just what are you going to tell her whenever, you know, she says, oh, well, honey, we've been with this company for 15 years. And, you know, why don't we just stay with them? You're going to be able to tell her, you know, hey, this guy's great. He solved all our needs. He's going to be able to, you know, our trucks are going to his trucks look clean. So it's not going to give us a customer's a bad rap or, you know, are you to be able to walk through all those things with her, Claude?
Yeah, absolutely. You did a great job, man. You're the best salesman I've ever met. I'm going to tell her all about you and everything. And yeah, this is great stuff.
That's awesome, Claude. I really appreciate that. And, you know, if she has any questions, I'll be glad to talk with her as well. You know, I'm certainly glad to do that, but you know, I'm really looking forward to work with you. You sound like a man of your word, Claude. Why do I get the feeling that, we're going to be able to do business together for a long time?
You've been what I'm looking for. Your product, your pricing, it's perfect for us.
Awesome. So 100% we're doing business. Anything possibly keep us from doing business?
That's off the role play. That's the question I was waiting for. Claude, is there any reason why you'd call me tomorrow and say you had a change of heart, a change of mind or anything? You know, something like that.
Awesome.
Get me to put the last nail in the coffin here. You're on a honeymoon anyway. We're having a bro fest. Now's the time to push it over the limit. Go ahead. Can you guys still hear me? We good?
He was muted.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry, technical problem.
Claude, you're a man of your word. You're not going to call me tomorrow and change your mind. Hit me with that dangerous shit. Right now.
Hey, Claude, you sound like a great guy. We're going to, you sound like a man of your word, but there's no reason. You're not going to call me tomorrow or next Tuesday and say, oh, I talked to my wife and, you know, she didn't want to do it. She wants to stick this whole company. No. You're not going to put me through that, are you, Claude? We spent a lot of time here together.
I would never do that to you. I'm in sales, too. I would never do that to a fellow salesman. You're a great guy. You've been nothing but patient. No, my word is my bond, man.
Like, I appreciate that, man. But look, if there's anything, it's okay to tell me no, Claude. Like, I like you. We're still going to do friends even if we don't do business. But, you know, I'd rather you tell me no now, face-to-face or over the phone instead of calling me later, Claude. No, you're not going to do it like that, all right, Claude?
No, can't you accept yes for an answer? I don't want to say no.
All right, cool. Well, what was your credit card number?
Boom, that's it. That is a post-sale step. It is so, how come this is what million-dollar salespeople. These are the techniques that they use. Did we learn something today?
Who learned?
Yes.
Anybody? That was awesome. Okay. He went straight from absolutely not to, you know, no, there's not, I'm doing this too. Okay, what's your credit card number?
Yeah.
Like, that was beautiful.
You got, listen, you bought me a couple drinks. Go for the kiss, okay? This is a bad visual right now. I'm sorry. but go. Life is short. Go for it. You're good people. You are decent, hardworking people. You are ethical people. You are the people in this room who are making the world a better place. Don't be scared to ask for what you deserve in life. Can I have an amen from everybody?
Amen. Amen.